exceptional opportunity presented to you today as part of BCC's eighth One Book project, The Martian by Andy Weir. My name is Connie Trepiena, and before I introduce our very special guest speaker today, it is my pleasure to present the president of Bristol Community College, Dr. John J. Sprager, to say a few words.
Well, thank you, Connie, and welcome, everyone. What a wonderful event this is, and I'm so glad you could come and make it. We're very proud of our One Book Club and a One Book activity. Connie mentioned to me just now that she's been a member since the start, which is 8 years ago. So for 8 years, we've been having One Book Clubs, and I hope we have a centralized list of all the books that we've covered. It's very important in the intellectual activity of the college to have this focused discussion that the One Book activity enables us to undertake, so that we have lots of courses, lots of topics, lots of books that are required or even for personal reading and personal pleasure, but to have our entire family focused on a topic for a period of time really is something I think that brings the essence of our academic spirit to what we are at BCC and what makes us tick. And to focus our energies like this is amazing. And I'm very proud of the One Book Club. I want to mention and give a shout out to Susan Mortsuza, who is the chair of the One Book activity, but a number of people serve on the committees and provide activities such as this and that enhance the One Book itself. You remember last year and the years before, we've had similar other activities related to the central book. So it just, what, it enriches our conversations that we're able to have throughout the year, not just this semester, but the rest of the year as well. So very excited about our guest. I did want to point out to you something about flight, okay? Way back when the day I earned my wings, I bought a plaque with the inscription of the poem High Flight. I think every pilot does that, at least to give to your mother or someone anyway. And some of the lines of it always have stuck with me. John Gillespie McGee Jr. was enlisted in the Royal Canadian Air Force, wrote this poem in September, October of 1941, and within a few months he was gone, killed in December of 41. But as he extolled the value of flying and the unique experience it is to be a pilot, I wanted to mention to you a couple of lines that he used, and about slipping the surly bonds of earth and done hundreds of things that you have not even dreamed of. And I used to identify with that as a pilot, but our guest today has done thousands of things that that we have not been able to dream of, and extraordinary experience. And another great thing, I'm not here to introduce him, but I did want to point out that he is in our academic community at Texas Tech, and our whole academic life as colleagues in learning, what an honor and pleasure it is to have him be in our academic family. So I'm sure you're going to enjoy this wonderful presentation, and I'm going to turn it back now to Connie to come and make the formal introduction. Connie Trepiena.
Thank you, President Sprager. We are streaming this event on the BCC Facebook page so that students on all BCC campuses have the opportunity to see Dean Sacco's presentation. Students watching on Facebook may use the comment section to post comments or questions. And now, before I bring him out, let me tell you a little bit about our guest speaker, Dr. Al Sacco Jr. He is the Dean of the Edward E. Whitaker Jr. College of Engineering at Texas Tech University and an honest-to-God astronaut. And if that isn't enough, Dean Sacco is a distinguished professor, chemist, engineer, educator, researcher, advisor, author, and worldwide speaker with awards and honors too numerous to mention. I suggest you check out his 61-page curriculum vitae on the TTU website. Gee, I wonder what he does in his spare time. Much like astronaut Mark Watney in The Martian, Dr. Sacco, a member of NASA's STS-73 mission, blasted off into space in 1995 on the Space Shuttle Columbia for a 16-day mission as the payload specialist. I ask you, who better to tell us what space travel is really like than someone who has actually been there? To quote Teddy Sanders, who is the NASA's chief director in The Martian, as they discuss plans to rescue astronaut Watney, he says, "Astronauts are inherently insane and really noble." Dean Sacco may care to weigh in on that comment. But let us remember the words of President Ronald Reagan, who spoke to the nation just after the Challenger tragedy. He said, "The future doesn't belong to the faint-hearted. It belongs to the brave." On that note, and without further ado, let's give a warm BCC welcome to Dean Al Sacco.
So we'll see if we can get this working now. Well, let me start out by saying, never let your fears get in the way of your dreams, and I'll end up with that in the end. I'm talking specifically to everyone here that has ever wanted to really do something, because what I found in my life is it's you that limit yourself, not others. You begin to lose faith in yourself, and as soon as you do that, you've lost. So we're going to talk a little bit about that. But what does it feel like to sit on 7.5 million pounds of thrust, the equivalent of a low-level nuclear blast, and go from 0 to 17,596 miles an hour in 8.5 minutes. Now that, to put that in another perspective, that's 4.3 miles a second. That means you go around the world in 90 minutes, coast to coast in a little under 11 minutes. What really makes it impressive though is when you realize it's 10 times faster than a bullet out of a rifle barrel. So I've gone faster than a speeding bullet, so you know, it's a Superman kind of thing, But anyways, what is it like to really be an astronaut? What is it like? You've got an idea from The Martian is one of them, by the way, which is the most realistic. And the real realistic part of that is when he's on the surface of Mars. And the reason that's realistic is I was the one that wrote that manual that they quoted on how to grow potatoes and all that kind of good stuff. So that part's real. The blasting off part and stuff, well, maybe not so much, but it's really cool. For those of you that want to be an astronaut, people often say you have to have a good math and science, and that's in fact true, but the most important thing is reading comprehensive, hence your one book club, right? Reading comprehensive, why is that? Well, to give you an idea, and the shuttle was the most complex vehicle ever conceived by human beings. If I took all the wires in the shuttle and I put them end to end, they go around the Earth one time, right? 26,000 miles of wire. So when something goes wrong, you're not going to remember where the circuit is and how to fix it. You have to be able to pull it up on an iPad, read, understand what to do, and really correct it very quickly. So one of the things they want is reading comprehension is an absolute key if you want to be in the astronaut office, because you have to be able to do things quickly. But we started training 3 years before our flight. Let me introduce you first to the crew of STS-73, I hope. I'll introduce you to the crew. If it works this way. All right, this is the crew of STS-73. You know it as a shuttle flight. NASA calls the Space Transportation System Flight 73. Wearing our launch and entry suits, which we call pumpkin suits because they're orange, exactly, right? Standing to the far left, that's Katie Coleman, a PhD in organic chemistry from the University of Massachusetts. That's me sitting down on the left-hand side as you look at it with a little bit more hair and a little younger. Now I have more hair on my face than I do on the top of my head, but anyways. Then our pilot is standing to her left, your right, the balding fellow, that's Ken Bowersox. We used to call him Sox. We have commanders and pilots, and what I'll explain to that, left-hand seat is usually in civilian aviation, what you call your pilot, and the right-hand seat is the co-pilot, but everybody at NASA is a pretty good aviator. They're in the top 0.1% of the aviators in this country, so none of them allow themselves to be called co-pilots. So we have commanders, which is the guy that sits in the left-hand seat, and pilots in the right-hand seat, because none of us would want to be called a co-pilot. That's a bad thing, I guess, but so our commander is Ken Bowersox, and standing to his left, your right, that's Fred Leslie, PhD in atmospheric science and fluid physics from Purdue. Probably the smartest person that I've ever met. Standing to his left, your right, that's Kathy Thornton, PhD in nuclear physics from the University of Virginia, the woman that repaired the Hubble telescope. And you remember that from your textbooks. And then me sitting down here, and Ken Rominger, he's a civil engineer, a master's degree in aeronautics and astronautics from Columbia University, also would be the equivalent of the Iceman in the Top Gun movie with Tom Cruise. He really is, though, the real deal. And he could fly an airplane like you and I walk. He was an amazing guy. And sitting to the far right, as you look at it, that's Mike Lopez Alegria. We called him L.A., first Spanish-born astronaut, also voted the most handsome person on the STS-73 crew by the female trainers. He also happened to be the only single one, but we won't mention that. But anyways, so this is the crew of STS-73. As I mentioned, we start training about 3 years before the flight. And you see Kathy up there, we have a full fidelity trainer. So everything is done just like you do here in school. You practice, 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 practice. That's how you learn. You learn by doing. You don't learn by reading about it. You read about it, then you do it. You do it, you do it. In our case, they timed everything. Because when you're traveling at 4.3 miles a second, you don't have a lot of chances to make mistakes and recover from them. So you got to recover very quickly. And so everything's timed. And on-orbit time for doing science even is $27,500 a minute. So we wanted to make sure that we got through the science, did it correctly, and did it in the most effective way possible. Again, you see us in the, what's called the mid-deck here. That's Larry DeLucas, he was a backup, and myself. We're looking at the comm system. Again, remember, there's 26,000 miles of wiring. The food actually is, it doesn't look so appetizing, but it's great. It's not these, you know, out of a tube stuff. In fact, it's better than most of the restaurants that you'll go to around here, for sure, and in many big cities. It's really great, and it's customized. I had lobster Newburgh on orbit, all sorts of good stuff. So it's not what you expect. And then we have the toilet. You see that in the upper left or right as you look at it? Everybody always asks about that. We have a plunger. We don't really need a plunger because if it doesn't work, everything floats around, so that's not, but I was asked one time in a congressional meeting why it cost about $5 million for the toilet. I said, well, I want you to imagine all of a sudden the toilet not working, everything floating around and you floating through it. So we have to make sure it works. It's, for lack of a better description, it's a big vacuum cleaner. I'll leave your mind to the rest of that. Because of the Challenger accident, our government, in its infinite wisdom, decided we should bail out. We should be able to bail out. And here we're practicing, let's call it aggressive tuck and roll. And the reason I say, and we went through parachute training and all sorts of things, the reason I laugh at that is any of you that have flown aircraft that know that if you fly or try to bail out of an aircraft that's going over about 350 miles an hour, the shear as you clear the cockpit would break your back. We're traveling at 500 miles an hour when we clear the gantry that's holding the shuttle in place, which is only about 600 feet above the ground. So we could never bail out of the aircraft, but the government mandates that we do this. Because, see, none of our government people are that bright, as you probably figured out. But in any case, so we go through this, and it's just really foolish, but they require it, so we do it. Here's Kathy Thornton. The suit she has on weighs 65 pounds, the helmet about 25 pounds. So we have, you know, about 90 pounds here, roughly. She's taken herself down. She weighs 125 pounds. And the reason for that is there's top windows on top of the shuttle. That's 64 feet from the bottom. If we were able to crash, land, we'd go out the top windows. We also had to take a passport. That probably surprised you. It certainly surprised me. And we had to keep it with us in our flight suit all the time. And the reason for that was if we did crash land and manage to survive, which would be a miracle in itself, but if we did, if we landed in unfriendly areas, they would, in fact, keep us there, unless we had a passport, because it would be illegal, and they'd try to use us for ransom. So we had to take a passport. So my passport's been around the Earth about 1,000 times or so, but hadn't got any stamps in it, you know? We did a lot of survival training, again, in case we parachuted out, which we all know we couldn't do. But so we went, and I learned how to eat cockroaches, you know, eat raw fish, eat a seagull. There's only one part of a seagull. I know you have seagulls around here. There's only one part of a seagull you can eat, so I'll just give you the little hint. It's right under his beak area. The rest of it, you're going to get pretty sick. So, but they really have an attitude if you try to kill them, you know, they really... And what they do to test us on this is we jump out of a Learjet at about 40,000 feet, and we parachute down in the middle of the night. They do all sorts of nasty things, like put holes in your raft, and you have to patch it at night, and all sorts of stuff, and you're all by yourself. And then you get to eat. They leave you water, but that's it for 5 days, and you sort of float around and try to catch a seagull. I got a seagull, but it really, he pooped all over me, I'll say that. But. Real attitude, but nevertheless. So you see, survival training I really liked, as you can see from the picture on the right-hand side. It was a lot of fun. But I did get to ride a centrifuge, so I want you to imagine for 1 minute in your mind's eye sitting inside something with no windows, having no sense of motion, have them spin you around. It's like you're on a ball on the end of a string. But what you begin to feel is an elephant sitting on your chest. In our particular flight profile, we were going to pull 3.5 Gs, which means if you weighed 100 pounds, you weigh 350 pounds. And so they strap you in, and you're going around, and you have no sense of motion, but you feel this elephant sitting on your chest. They tell you to do things. And so being the good astronaut that I was, we always follow instructions. So they hadn't put my visor down. So they said, Al, we want you to put your visor down. So I struggled to get my arm up, because now it weighs about 80 pounds. And I slapped the visor in place, and I feel real good about myself. And then I made the critical mistake. They said, now we want you to shake your head back and forth as fast as you can. Now, I'm sure you would have been smarter than I was, because you all know your balance is in the liquid in the bottom of your ear. So when you're spinning around at 3.5 Gs, it's spread over the back part of your ear. And when you shake your ear, of course, it comes off. And when it comes off, the physiological response of the body is the projectile vomit, which I did. It went all over the face paint and all over my face. Yeah, and just like you're laughing, I heard this hysterical laughter going, ha. And they recorded it. Now, I'm not going to show you a close-up picture, but I'll just say they recorded it. And they always say if you get too big for your britches, they're going to publish those papers, those pictures. And they've done this for every astronaut crew, as far as I know, at least up through when I was in the astronaut corps. But NASA does everything for a reason. So what do you know during flight day? You're going to move your head? Because you learned that lesson, right? You know what's going to happen if you move your head. So you're not going to move your head. You're going to move your eyes. But your head isn't going to move at all. So if you see people in the movies moving their head, not so good. If you didn't know how to fly, they teach you how to fly. Flying is very easy. It's the landing part that can be tricky, but the rest of it's pretty straightforward. And we had a lot of fun. I had flown in the Navy before, so here I am flying down for our first launch attempt. You can guess which one is me. I always had a sense of humor. So I flew down from Houston down to the Cape, flying upside down. Now, we wear G-suits, which means they're like elastics that sort of press in on your thighs and in the middle of your stomach, and they keep the blood perfuse in your brain. So even though I flew upside down the whole way down, I felt just as comfortable as you feel sitting in the seat here. The real tricky part is the fly-in formation. That can be tough. But I was kidding our Top Gun pilots that I was as good as they were. I really wasn't, but I wanted to show them. They were always afraid I'd you know, hit the wing a little bit, but. And of course, when I get close to the Cape, the ground controller said, do you think you ought to turn it around before you try to land it? I'm gonna give you one physics question, because I think this is something people don't really realize. You see that structure on the left-hand side, right? That's the Eiffel Tower. Well, let's assume we could build an Eiffel Tower that was as high as the shuttle that I was in, which is about 350 miles. And I always ask the question, if I put a scale on top of that Eiffel Tower, how much would I weigh? And people often say zero gravity, because the astronauts float. But that's not, in fact, the case. If you do the physics, you can see it right up here. It's 86% of what you weigh in the ground, 0.86. So if I weighed 100 pounds, I weigh 86 pounds. And if I stepped off the Eiffel Tower, I would go all the way down, reach what we call terminal velocity, and then go splat. So the question is, why do you float? And the reason we float is because of that enormous speed, 4.3 miles a second, and I want you to visualize the Earth as a ball. So we're constantly falling off the edge of the ball. So you're really in the free fall environment of low Earth orbit. You're not in zero gravity. In fact, gravity is almost 90% of what it is here on the ground. But you're so fast, you're falling off the edge of the Earth. So what does it feel like when you first get into orbit? Have you ever been in a roller coaster that falls down all of a sudden, or an elevator that drops, or go over a big bump in your car, right? That's exactly what it feels like, except you never hit the ground. And then after a while, you adjust to it, and it's really cool. It's like just floating around like a leaf in a breeze. You don't have to use very many muscles. You just have to touch something very lightly. If you touch it too hard, like we do here against one gravity, and push off with your feet, you go flying to the other side and slam into the wall. And you can always tell a first-time flyer, because when they get out of their seat, they start flailing, just like people do when they're falling, because that's what you're doing, you're falling. And that's exactly what it feels like. So now you know what it feels like when you first get into orbit. So here we are, ready to launch. This is me, Fred, and Kathy. We have the absolutely useless parachutes on, which are extremely uncomfortable, but no one seems to care because the government says we should do it. So here we are, we have oxygen canisters as well. We're right underneath the flight deck. The flight deck's above us in this particular shot. I'm laying on my back. The seats are not nearly as comfortable as the seats that you're in. They're just aluminum frames to keep the weight down. And we sit there a maximum of 3 hours. If we don't get off in 3 hours, we have a flight rule because we can start getting blood clots and all sorts of different things. But so we're laying on our back, and then when it's time to go, they tell you, put down your visor, and you put down your visor 90 seconds before the engine's about to light. And what went through my mind, people often says what went through my mind, and there were two things. The first thing was the thing that you already know. Don't move your head, right? And the secondary thing that went through my mind is, oh, well, 8.5 minutes, I'm gonna have a lot of fun or I'm not gonna remember anything, because I got 8.5 minutes to survive. And then, what we call in the business, we light the candle. Feels very much like a truck that has bad shocks bouncing around with a huge gorilla sitting on your chest. And here's what we call going uphill. Here's another shot of that. These are taken by chase planes and cameras we have to look at things. Those solid rocket boosters, the white looking things that look like pencils on the side, the SRBs, are burning fuel at a rate of 1,000 pounds a second, right? Half the weight of your automobile every second. They burn typically for 180 seconds. The three main engines in the back are burning liquid hydrogen and oxygen that come together explosively, 2,000 gallons each, so that's 4,000 gallons for each engine. And they burn again for 180 to 200 seconds, roughly. The whole vehicle on launch weighs 4.5 million pounds. By the time we get to orbit, the orbiter, or the shuttle as you know it, weighs 250,000 pounds. So basically 4.25 million pounds of energy in a liquid and solid form in order to reach that enormous speed of 17,596 miles an hour so that we will fall off the edge of the Earth and won't be pulled back in by gravity. As we're going uphill, there are chase planes that are circling around taking pictures. Here we are in the region of maximum dynamic stress. At that point, we're compressing the air in front of us so much that if you look out the window, you see this beautiful rainbow. And again, you look out the window by moving your eyes, not your head. Right? You see this beautiful rainbow, but you're still bouncing around, and you're trying to breathe, and there's a way you breathe under those situations. And you're listening to the only ones allowed to talk is the commander, or what you'd call a pilot in civilian aviation, and we're all cueing off what he or she says. You get up to about 120,000 feet, you hear what sounds like a cap gun pop, pop, the vehicle shuttles to the right and the left. You look out the window and it's just bathed in flame. So all you see is fire all around you. Which, if you've never been in a fireball, is an experience. And you just hope it goes out in a few seconds, right? Because if it doesn't go out, it's a bad day, you know. And then we ride the three main engines into orbit, and that's the funniest part, because all of a sudden, all the vibration goes away. We're traveling now at such a speed at that altitude that the only sound you can hear is your own heartbeat and the commander, if he or she says anything, because that comes through your earphones that are in your ears. But you just hear your own heartbeat, pump, 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 or sometimes pump, 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 depending on how things are going. But it's as smooth as a canoe on the lake after those solid rocket boosters go off. And this was my first look at space. It's really much more beautiful than this. And it's the Earth is like a robin egg's blue. It just hangs in the blackest black you've ever seen, surrounded by billions of stars. So if you were to go out in the ocean here, off the bay, late at night and look up and multiply that by a billion times, you'd get a sense of what it is. But the real strange thing is that I wasn't prepared for is the fact that you can see the color of stars, the aging of stars, reds, yellows, greens. The reason you don't see it in the upper left here is because the reflection of the sun off the Earth is so bright, the aperture of the camera can't capture the billions of stars that are off to the left-hand side. But your eyes can see it. It's absolutely stunningly beautiful. And the other thing is, when you're in space, we're used to looking up to see stars. Now you can look down behind you, all around you. They're all around. So you're just, I mean, it's just amazing. This is our commander, Ken Bowersock, Sox. His job is really over for the time being. Ours is about to start. This is our flight 39B pad that we took off of. I don't know if you can see it. It's right up here. So this is one trip around the Earth. About this time, my job was to get out of my flight suit slowly, right? Because there's something called space adaptation sickness that happens with about 95% of the male crews and about 5% of the female crews. And it's due to a fluid shift. When you get into orbit, the baroreceptors in your neck don't realize that you're in this free-fall environment, so they continue to pump all the blood in your lower part of your body up into your upper part of your body. So the result is a couple of things. One is you feel like you're hanging upside down from a tree, right? If you have any wrinkles, they all go away. The women always have us take pictures in their shorts because everything gets small down here and big up here. So they always get pictures for their husbands, you know? But after about 3 or 4 days, depending on the individual, you urinate that out as plasma mass. You urinate about 32% of your plasma mass out as urine, and so you have to fluid load when we come back in. And then your muscles become very sinewy, and men and women begin to look the same in terms of their musculature. But about that time, I was asked to save the vehicle, which means to take what looked like circuit breakers from the launch position to the on-orbit position. And I got a call from the commander, and he said, send Sacco up here. And here I am floating up to the flight deck. And by the way, that thing that goes from my ear to the radio set, NASA calls that a wireless headset. If you can explain to me why that's a wireless headset, I'm willing to buy you dinner tonight. No one could ever explain that to me. I kept saying, it looks like a wire to me. And they said, no, it's a wireless headset. I don't know. But anyways, that's it. So floated up to the flight deck. And when I was a young child in high school, let's say, so not too much older than some of the folks here. Someone said, send Sacco down here. It was usually the principal or the president's office or something. It was always a bad thing. So when I heard this, I thought I had messed something up. But what he was doing is he was calling me up to see where we live, Massachusetts, Cape Cod, and the islands, which from orbit is just stunningly beautiful. It looks really, really cool. But my job was to get the science lab ready. Here's Kathy Thornton and I. We were members of the red team, so they gave us red shirts to wear most of the time in case we forgot who we were, I guess. And this is Velcro. You'll see Velcro everywhere because there's a slight conditioning of air in the shuttle in order to keep it fresh and pure. So if I was to leave a pen, it would just float off to the filters. So we have to Velcro everything to ourselves or to the wall or it disappears. But I love this picture because Kathy's having a bad hair day. I always point that out. But actually in orbit, if you're lucky enough to have a lot of hair, you have what was in the 60s called the perfect afro, because static charges build up along the follicles of your hair. And since you're in this free fall environment, you just form this perfect halo. The only reason that's behind her is she's moving her head forward as this picture was taken. Otherwise, it would be all just about around her head. My first day in orbit, I was talking to you about the fluid shift part of it and probably didn't finish the story. The reason they think that women don't get it is women get a monthly fluid shift, so their mind is used to it, men don't. So you can imagine the ribbing we take. So we get sick, men usually get sick in orbit, at least for the first 24 hours or so. Not always, but sometimes. But I was so thirsty. Because of that, we don't, even though you see on CNN and stuff when the space flight went out there, you see them eating breakfast, they're not really eating anything. If you look at the guys, they're sort of moving stuff around. They put the water glass up, they move stuff around, because they don't want us to eat. The women eat, but the guys don't, you know? So, but I was so thirsty. This is about 14 hours after our flight, and I'll point out two things to you. One is that I'm not wearing my wireless headset. We're always supposed to be in communication with the ground. But the second thing is, I said to them, I'm a scientist. I said, I want to study surface tension. Now, surface tension is the property of all liquids, and it's a very weak force. So on the ground, you know that every liquid that you have assumes the face or the shape of the vessel that it's in. So I look at this water, it assumes the shape of the vessel. But in orbit, this free fall environment, it wants to minimize its what we call surface energy and free energy. So it comes together as closely as possible, and that configuration is a sphere. So you see me squeezing out the fruit juice and I have a sphere. So I told them I wanted to study surface tension. I really wanted to drink it. But of course, when it was out there, now I've got this undulating red ball out there. Now, come on, what would you do? You're not going to drink it, right? It's just hanging out there, and you're floating out there. So what did I start to do? I started to blow it around. Then I forgot Newton's second law of motion. When you send something in motion, the only way to get it in the other direction is to put a force in the other direction, right? So pretty soon, I want you to imagine this is me in this fruit juice bouncing around a $500 million electronics lab. So suddenly, Kathy, who's taking these pictures with a big smile on her face, says to me, the ground wants you to drink the liquid. So the first thought I had was, what are they going to do about it? It's not like they can do anything about it, right? But what they do about it is they don't let you fly again. So I figured I better drink it. And then I learned something about orbital mechanics that I hadn't learned before, which is when you're in a three-dimensional environment, we live in a two-dimensional environment. So if I drop something, I know the plane to look at right away to look for it. But when you're in a three-dimensional environment, your eyes don't know where to focus. So when I tried, it was one thing to blow at this thing because I could roughly see the plane that it was in because it was moving in nine different axes and I was moving in nine different axes, but I could see roughly where it was. But when I tried to get it in my mouth, when it's in motion and I'm in motion, that was a whole different thing, right? So it took me a while, and I'm not going to show you the picture, but at the end, I look like Bozo the Clown with the juice on my nose. It wasn't a pretty sight, but finally got it. So now here's Mike Lopez Alegría, our handsome astronaut, with his wireless headset on, with an F4 camera and a film in front of it. So now I'm going to take you around the world really quick. This is what the moon looked like from space. Again, you'd see billions of stars as well. You could see the so-called seas of the moon. Three quarters of the time when we looked out the window, we saw ocean because the Earth is three quarters water, right? This is the Hawaiian Islands, Maui, and they were having trouble with their pineapple crops, so we can use infrared radiation and others to determine the moisture content down to about a centimeter, a quarter of an inch, and from that determine the infestations and tell the farmers what to do. We did the same thing for the King of Thailand. This is what that looks like. We could get that down to a quarter of an inch, that red, that's moisture. Coming up on the west coast of the US, this was taken by a pilot. How do I know? They always took pictures of airports. It's a pilot thing, right? They always wanted to see where they could potentially land if there was a problem. You can also see, it's very easy to see pollution. This is San Francisco Bay. Swinging across the US, that red, characteristic red, is characteristic, of course, of iron oxides, rust, if you will, in the soils. This is part of the Lake Powell, part of the dammed up Colorado River. And of course, New Orleans is typical of any city within the US or elsewhere. This is before the hurricane, about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And you see that straight line, that's a bridge. Nature does everything in curves, so anytime you see a straight line, it's human made. Coming up in the Cayman Islands, and you see that that's due to not erosion, but pollution off of Grand Cayman. So if you went to the Cayman Islands in the 90s, they've cleaned it up a little bit since that, you'd go out and you'd see 200-foot visibility, be crystal clear. But you'd notice the coral was white, and real coral's not white, right, if it's alive. And you'd see a lot of beautiful fish, but they'd all be small because they're trying to get away from the big fish trying to eat them. But they polluted up to 4 miles off their coast. We showed them this picture and they began to change that because they used to dump their municipal waste. This is coming up in London and Ireland. I point out where it is because you probably can't see it that well. And as we come up with the Terminator here, you can see England up there and Ireland, Spain, the boot of Italy on the right-hand side. And then you see a series of islands coming up here. Cape Verde Islands, Canary, Madeira, and of course, Greenland. And I point this out, this is a dust storm coming off of Western Africa, and these red dots are fires that we could see from Europe. But I bring this up to remind you that we are in a very small planet, even though it seems very big to you, and anything that they do, or we do, pollution-wise, gets carried. So that dust, we can identify as coming over Massachusetts, parts of it. Coming over Texas, coming everywhere. And anytime anybody pollutes anywhere, it affects us. So it's in our national interest and our health interest to not only clean up our act, but help other countries clean up theirs, because we're ingesting everything that they pump out. It just gets diluted a little bit, but we're still ingesting it. So all over the world this travels. This is what it looks like, London looks like during the day. And what it looks like at night. And we were asked to look for the Loch Ness Monster. I could never figure that out, but. The boot of Italy, my dad was an immigrant from Italy, as many of our families were way back when. He moved in the North End, and he met my Irish mother from County Cork, Ireland. Neither one of them had a high school education, but they brought up four kids that did. And so he used to tell me all the time, what he didn't like about Americans is they didn't know their geography. So I took this picture of the boot of Italy for him, and then took a close-up and presented it to him, and he said, great picture of Cape Cod. Forever put into bed the idea that he knew more about geography than I did. But nevertheless, coming up in the Middle East, a beautiful area and unpolluted off the tip. Athens, Syria, and that anchor is the Great Salt Lake in Turkey and Northeast Cyprus. And then a fascinating part of the world, which is the Bosphorus, which separates Asia from Europe. Again, this is Izmir as we fly across, and then Israel. And here's what you see is a straight line, right? I don't know whether you can make this out because the lights are bright, but a straight line is human-made. On the left-hand side is Egypt, and they allow their goats to eat all the vegetation right up to the fence. And this is Bathsheba, where the Israelis put them in pens, so I remember this with goats and no goats. Interesting part. Another beautiful part of the world, but troubled. And then coming up in the Himalayas, the Brahmaputra River, snow on the Himalayas, and then as we went over the top, much of the snow has never melted since it was first formed. So you're looking back in history. It's just amazing. Southeast Asia, Burma, what was then called Burma, now is Myanmar. Beautiful area of the world. This is actually pollution out of Bangkok. If you've ever been in Bangkok, you'll know what I mean. They wear surgical masks about 3 o'clock in the afternoon because of the pollution. They have the same traffic we have here in 128 going into Boston. The difference is they don't have pollution control on their cars, so there's just a smog everywhere. So again, that smog eventually reaches us. Here we are in Australian outback. Again, characteristic red of iron oxides in the soil. We live in a beautiful planet. This is Hurricane Angela. It hit 200 mile an hour winds, hit Indonesia. We tracked it for the National Weather Service. The eye of the hurricane on the right-hand side to the outside is about 1,500 miles. And here's, I saw a sunrise and sunset, because if you go around the world in 90 minutes, right, you see a sunrise and sunset. In our case, it was 54 minutes of light when the sun was on one side and 36 minutes of darkness on the other. And so every time we'd see a different sunrise or sunset. They were always beautiful, they were always different. Oh yeah, I wasn't supposed to show you that. But I went up there to do some science in space, and we talked about the fun of going up there, but these are zeolite crystals. They produce all the world's gasoline. We were trying to figure out how to grow them with fewer defects and larger in size, so you see the crystals that we grew in space versus what was the best ones at the time grown in the ground. You see, the normal position in space, by the way, is the fetal position. Your body is like this, so we take advantage of that ergonomically. This is a T-bar, so we just wrap our legs around it, our knees around it, and I'm just sort of floating there. But you're always, so you'll see me sitting in some pictures, but I'm not really sitting. All I do is put Velcro on the bottom of my socks, and I just Velcro myself to the ceiling, the wall, wherever I want to Velcro myself to. You're going to see some of this. I'm going to show you in a movie about this in a minute. So here I am, hanging off the T-bar, mad scientist at work here. But one of the things I'm very proud of, we grew a lot of proteins in space. This is isocitrate lyonase, which is a storage protein for tobacco plants, actually. The left-hand side is what was grown, the best crystal grown on the ground. This is an electronic map of that. This is the same crystal I grew in orbit, the exact same thing, and that's the electronic map on the upper right. So why is this important to you? Well, we grew the HIV crystals in orbit, right, AIDS. And we can get such a three-dimensional picture of this. You can visualize it in your mind as being able to get a three-dimensional picture of a lock. Scientists then can design a key that physically fits and chemically binds to the active site. It's called rational drug design. And that's what we did. We grew one or two of the proteins for HIV/AIDS that was used in development of the retro drugs. So we do a lot of stuff that helps us on the ground you don't even hear about here. We did combustion experiments in space. I show you this one. Just a simple experiment like this. This is a candle, right? Like a birthday candle. Now, if you did this on the ground here, you'd hold a candle because you're not in a free fall environment, right? You'd heat the air around it. It would go up and burn your fingers. In space, though, it just hangs there. And I can put another candle. I don't know if this will show, but I could put another candle right here, and it would not ignite, because the combustion limits are different in orbit. That's a diffusion-starved flame, they call it. So why is that important to you? You know the cell phones you have, all you guys love, and the TV that goes through the satellites? The reason we can do that is we can jam so many components close to each other, and we don't have to worry about fire or overheating, right? And simple experiments like this told us how to design the space station, how to design those satellites. We grew the first potatoes in space ever grown. They grew faster and better. The carbohydrates were distributed differently. I'm not sure why that is, but we wanted to eat them after 15 days or so, but then they would have to dissect us to get at them, so we thought we'd pass on that. We're also looking at making alloys. Now, this happens to be a laser light projection of bauxite, aluminum oxide particles in a silicon drop. But why is this important? You see different patterns. We were trying to make alloys that would respond to a temperature and would twist and turn in different ways. Now, why is that important to you, or was important to us? We were trying to make engines, rocket engines, that had no moving parts, that we could just heat on one side and they could throttle the engine, they could open it up, they could close the throttling valves. That's the future of the space program, right? Non-moving parts mean what? Nothing breaks. Right? And that's the big problem in orbit. When things break, things are really bad. Unless you anticipated that break, you're in real trouble. And going on to Mars, the Martian you read, right? A lot of these engines are being developed for that. And the reason for that is if something breaks and they didn't happen to anticipate that break, you are really out of luck. right? Or let's say, if it wasn't for bad luck, you'd have no luck at all, but... So we did a lot of things. We took advantage of everyone, and this is what I suggest to students and faculty and everybody alike. Everybody has positives and negatives, and we always took advantage of people's positives, downplayed their negatives, right? And no matter what it was, everybody has positives and negatives, and take advantage of that. In this particular case, Kathy's, who's scientific, is talking to our commander, our pilot. He doesn't know that much about science, but he has acute eyesight. So we had him looking at things to see, do you see something we don't see? Not the amount of things we see, but some of us, sometimes scientists, we read so much, we anticipate based on what we read, what we expect to see. So instead of seeing what's really there, we see what we were told is there. And the difference between a Nobel Prize winner, and you often hear this, and one that isn't, is the person that saw something that everybody else looked at and never thought about it. That's because he got locked into a paradigm. So we'd bring the pilots up to say, what do you see? And they'd help us interpret what we saw. We all are used to touchscreen computers and touchscreen phones. We were the first flight that piloted that for Apple, which, by the way, was the dumbest idea that I ever heard of. Because I want you to think about it for a second. Touchscreens, right? So in orbit, I touch the screen touches me, equal and opposite. I go that way, it doesn't do anything, right? Right, so here we have a bunch of people flown in space for a long time and we forgot the physics. So thank goodness we had handholds. You see Kathy Helen on the handholds? So we could hold it, so when we pushed it, it didn't go. But if we just floated up and pushed it, it didn't go anywhere. We went in the other direction, you know? But we tested it and now you guys see that it works. Didn't work so well for us in orbit, they don't have those anymore. We had exercise every day. Because you're in this free fall environment, you don't lose the major muscle groups, including your heart. Your heart doesn't have to beat very hard. And what happens in your decondition, what you didn't know is during the Apollo missions, we had several cardiac incidents, meaning irregular heartbeats that developed, a lot of other things in orbit. And that's because your heart deconditioned. So we have a flight rule. We have to exercise 90 minutes a day. 90 minutes. So we would get on a bike. We'd strap ourselves in. Here's Katie on the bike. We could adjust the work level and would bike all the way around the world while looking at that beautiful sight. And here's Kathy and I, snack time. She has a strawberry sundae. What she doesn't know is I'm eating her shrimp cocktail. And we've got our feet Velcro to the floor, so it looks like we're sitting. And Kathy was always smarter than me. She said to me, if we don't float this out front, it's not gonna look like we're in space. So she was right, it wouldn't look like we're in space, but behind us are our sleeping quarters. They were like kitchen cabinets. We just sort of float in there, put our music on, shut the door. You only need about 2/3 of the amount of sleep you have here on the ground. So if you normally sleep 8 hours, you need 6 hours and feel the same. If you normally sleep 6 hours, you need 4 hours and feel the same. But by flight rule, because it's a military, based on a lot of military flight rules, we had to stay in bed for 8 hours anyways. So you weren't allowed to get out. You stayed there. So we would read. Right? And people often say, what did you read? Did you read a book? I brought a lot of books up, but I didn't read a single book. What I did is read what I was going to do the next day, because I was always afraid I was going to mess up someone's experiment. So I'd be reading through everything again and again. And I had all notes I had taken during my training, the 3 years of training, to make sure I didn't mess anything up for anybody. But I only typically sleep 6 hours a night, so I 4 hours there, I was just reading flight manuals, you know, going through one after another, begging the commander to come out and let me get out, but he never would. Here we are getting ready. Kathy, I'll tell you another funny story about space flight. I was always, warm. That's why I'm wearing shorts. She was always cold. So we had a manual adjustment to the temperature. So about day 4 on the orbiter, we got a call up and they called us up. We were called the red shift. I told you about that. And they said, we have a problem with the temperature. And they said, what do you mean? And they said, about every 3 hours, the temperature shifts about 7 degrees in a sinusoidal manner. It's not completely, the period's not always the same, but it's pretty close. So I looked at her and she looked at me. So what happened is when I got hot, I would dial down, I'd float by and dial down the temperature on my way to whatever I was doing. It would start getting cooler, I'd feel comfortable. She'd get cold, she'd float by and dial it up. So we would just, so we had to come to a compromise. And again, I love these pictures because of the bad hair days, you know. The red team and the blue team. Here we are coming back. We deorbit burn over Australia, throw out all the hydrazine, all the fuel, and then we glide in. And believe me, this glide ratio is like as one person described it, is like flying a bomb. In other words, it doesn't have a glide ratio, it just comes straight down. Everybody takes a picture like this. I took this for my mother, which she said I could do with Photoshop, which I probably could have, but. And then, of course, this is Aspie the alien. I'm not supposed to show you him. And we landed 16 days later. So what's the future? You know that as the International Space Station? Solar panels are in our future, and there's no question about it. Wind, alternate energy sources. These are amazing. At the time, they were the most efficient, and they're still pretty close to the most efficient. That's how sad it is in terms of what we develop solar energy-wise. But they're about 36% efficiency. To give you an idea, the worst power plant I've ever seen is about 48% efficient. Most of them are now about 65% efficient. So what that means is we have a long way to go before we compete with fossil fuels, but we need to do it. But these are amazing. They bring them up as, they look like an accordion, and then they spread them out. So civil engineers get involved, material engineers, chemical engineers, mechanical engineers, electrical engineers. Here's a friend of mine. They sent me this picture waving. Astronauts wave when they want to kid you that they're there and you're not. Just amazing structures here in the International Space Station. I want to show you this because we were the first crew that did this. Remember I told you we had 36 minutes of darkness and we put a camera in the window, open up the aperture and take a picture and then slice it together. The reason I show this to all audiences, you see all those bright areas? It's a very good idea who uses all the electricity and the energy. And you can see the U.S. from the central part to the east coast and on the west coast is a big user. Very little in South America, almost none in Africa, very little in Australia, very little in China. Japan up there in the upper right and Europe have lit up like light bulbs. The reason we have terrorism is because everybody in those dark areas want to live like you live. They want to have food, they want to have clean water, they want to have a happy life. And so the challenge to our generation, all of us, like I talked about pollution, is we have to provide energy to these folks so they can do these. So I always say, my grand challenge is to you, this, I usually say this to students, but I'll say this to all of us, adults as well, is we need to improve energy availability and alternate energy sources. With that, we need to production of food and clean water and its distribution worldwide. The control of pandemics and personalized medical care. You heard about that with Ebola, right? That's only going to get worse, not better, if we don't address it. And the one thing I'll say to the students and to the adults here, and you do it here at BCC, is sustainable education. You're going to have to retrain yourself, always. And I'm going to tell you something else that people don't want to hear, is that even when you graduate from this great institution, you go off to work, the rate at which information is changing, you're going to have to retrain yourself every 4 years. You're not going to be able to come back to school. So you're going to have to use those cell phones and train yourself. So learn how to learn. Learn how you learn. Some people are visual learners. Some people have to read multiple times, which is what I was. I was sort of a combination of both. You have to learn how to learn because you're going to constantly have to re-educate yourself or you're going to lose your job. The good news is you have the capability to do it, but you have to learn how to do it. And you have to be serious about it. And then you're going to have a great life in front of you. So this is me and my other flight. It's a DOD flight, so they don't talk about that very much, but we're repairing a satellite. It's always great to go outside. That's fun. And come join the adventure in science and engineering, but really it's in any way you can get educated, you can contribute to society. So what I want to do now is just real quick is show you a movie that I hope will bring this all home to you.
Our rally caps. It must have worked because we managed to launch.
This will be about 15 minutes, but you tie all this stuff I said together.
Here we are, the launch pad, the final few seconds, and a f- feeling like we're finally going to go. We heard the main engine start at about 6 seconds prior to the launch. We could feel the twang, as they call it, and then at booster ignition, off we went. And I'll tell you, it was quite a ride. I guess from the ground, it looked pretty spectacular because the shuttle was hidden by the smoke and vapor right after liftoff. As I mentioned before, we were all pretty happy on Ascend, having an opportunity to look out the window, feeling comfortable. And one name I didn't mention that I really ought to is Joy Barkholt. She was the team lead of all the trainers, and she really pulled us and
we
them
do this
together,
for our trainers to give them an idea of
we were going uphill,
what we did.
Pretty quickly. At this point, you'll start to see some vapors as the shockwaves build up on the nose of the orbiter and external tank as we pass through the region of maximum dynamic pressure here. The shuttle really vibrates a lot. It's, you know, it's the ride of your life. That's about all I can say. This is a nice view of us as we punch through a cloud deck there, and the shadow gets cast on the top of the clouds. SRB separation was just like it is in the simulator, I thought. A bright flash, a little pop, and all of a sudden the ride changes from being really abrupt to and vibration to very smooth.
First thing we do on orbit is open the doors and deploy the Ku band.
We open the doors to dissipate the heat, just like when you open an oven door.
That, of course, is the source of all the TV. And on this particular mission, we had digital data, 6 channels of digital TV down for the experiments, which was really just great in terms of data management and resource management for us on board and the folks on the ground. But the first job that, right after opening the doors, what Mike and Fred and I had to do as the blue shift or the night shift was go to bed. This is probably the hardest thing that we had to do the whole mission because it was just, I just can't tell you how exciting Ascent was. It, as Mike said, it's the ride of your life, and it's something I just still look back on and just grin. And going to bed, well, I'll just say, at least we shut the doors.
In addition to wearing our caps backward, I wore my lucky socks on the day that we finally got launched. That was the key to it. 2 St. Christopher medals didn't get us off on the second attempt, but the socks did it. After 30 days of quarantine, I knew I was ready to launch, but I wasn't sure I could remember what the mission was. But when it came time to do space lab activation, it was just like in the simulator, only nothing broke, and everything powered up just like it was supposed to. We didn't power off the lab, and we didn't do any hot coupler swaps, so we stayed in good graces there. Everything came up just like it was supposed to. We were amazed and delighted. We had a fairly light day scheduled on the first day to accommodate anybody who might not feel well or space lab systems that might not feel well, and we didn't have any of those problems. So what we ended up doing on our first day is really set the laboratory up well for a 2-week
See the Velcro?
Space station.
Those are Velcro patches all over the place.
Make it useful to do all the experiments we needed to do over that time.
Well, Kathy, now we're setting up the lab. Kit and I were doing a trim burn to get us just in the right orbit. We rolled the payload bay door partially in on the port side and went into the gravity gradient attitude. Then the next 15 days were pretty much the same, and they usually started like this.
Hey, much like out here on Earth, you brush your teeth. What I wasn't prepared
That's
for
me shaving.
I was done brushing my teeth. There's no sink up there to spit this stuff out in, and so yeah, I had to have an alternate plan, and mine was to kind of swallow it, and it didn't work out that well. You saw Al shaving, which is very much like here on Earth, and Mike now is riding the ergometer, and that was our main means of exercise, and we exercised every day on orbit. Along with exercise, though, comes the overhead of cleaning up. And without a shower, the sponge baths take a while. And then also wash on our hair. We had a rinseless shampoo that worked really well, and Katie's demonstrating it for us here. And you'll see in a minute, she's managed to get her hair dry.
I figure if I keep my hair clean, everybody can. It worked out just great, actually. I was a little worried about it before flight, but keeping clean up there was no problem. Now this is, I'm at the glove box doing that protein crystal growth there. And I'm actually using a restraint system developed here at JSC called Albert. We refer to this as Albert the Thing, as opposed to Albert, the payload specialist. And I'm working on protein crystal growth. And as you know, these crystals are used to help design drugs for diseases. And it's kind of a lock and key sort of effect, where if we can grow more perfect crystals, we know what the lock looks like, and the drug is then the key.
Here I am at the glove box again on Albert, so to speak, or Al squared. And we're working in the glove box, and I'm really looking at mixing profiles. It's very important in the zeolite community. Some of the zeolite community don't recognize that, but it is when you bring two reacting liquids together. And on orbit, we have some special problems. This is the bubble generation. Here we talk about bubbles, so sometimes we don't want those bubbles. And so now that we have them, what do we do? And what we do with them, and this is the main experiment that I use that information to power up and to generate, is you'll see me rotate this cylinder, which has the solutions in them after we mix them. And we rotate it not to take advantage of centrifugal force and throw the heavier fluids to the outside, the bubbles to the inside, so they make one big bubble, which doesn't have what we call a lot of nucleation sites and allow us to grow fewer but larger crystals with fewer defects. So that's one of the things that we had learned in USM-01 and confirmed again on SpaceX. This is called CGF. We're doing electronic crystal growth here, and Kathy's in the glove box, a closed area. Very difficult task to take in and out what we call SACAs, and I help her a little bit once in a while, and the command is documenting it, so if we make a mistake, everybody knows we made a mistake. But we didn't make any mistakes that we'll admit to. And here I am taking the SACA very carefully down to stow, because as all PIs, including myself, they're a little bit paranoid about shaking and vibrating, so it'd be a terrible thing for one of the PIs.
You know, so we have those loops in the floor so we can position ourselves and loop into.
In this shot, I'm interacting with the geophysical fluid flow cell experiment. This experiment, again, simulates convection on in planetary atmospheres. In this view, you can think of it as a weather satellite, basically looking at the southern hemisphere of the planet. The pole is at the bottom of the screen, and the equator is at the top, and you can see waves propagating around the equator, and somewhat reminiscent of cold fronts propagating down from the pole. Another fluid experiment was the surface tension-driven convection experiment. We all spent a lot of time on that one as well. Basically, in that experiment, you can heat the top surface of the liquid, and because there's a variation in surface tension with temperature, a fluid flow occurs at the surface and also drags around the interior of the fluid. And this experiment has a lot of importance not only to the film coating industry, but also has impact on crystal growth. In this fluid experiment, we were looking at manipulating a drop using acoustic fields. This experiment also had applications to drug delivery systems, and there's a lot of interest in surfactants. In this particular case, we're rotating a drop until it fissions.
This was one of the experiments that we all fought to do. Get up in the morning, you were always tempted to actually change the payload activity plan so that you'd be the one doing drop physics. Because as you can see, each input that you make to this acoustic chamber actually changes very dramatically what the drop does. And so we have a chamber with speakers on all sides, and we're changing literally the speaker pressure to distort the drop and also to do to maybe spin it around like this. What you're going to see coming up is, in just a minute, is one particularly interesting experiment that we did where we actually brought two fluids together. This isn't quite it yet, but we used this experiment to learn what happens when we do have two fluids, with what happens when we have a bubble inside a bubble. But when we brought these two fluids together, they actually had an interface in between them, which we refer to as the beach ball. And what this is going to be used for, it was a development model for actually forming vesicles for drug delivery systems. Now, we didn't really develop a drug delivery system, but we did look at the way two fluids would interact in a single chamber. You can see that's what happens when you do the wrong thing with the knob.
We had, as Katie said, six channels of video down, and this may be the first space flight or space lab flight ever where video downlink was not the limiting resource in planning. And also, most of the PIs left Marshall at the end of the mission with all of their data, whereas on USML-1 it took 7.5 months to get all their data out to them. So this was the first demonstration of that. It's something that we'll certainly need for space station. And the data uplink and downlink we had were kind of the first demonstrations of telescience that I think we've ever done. Another fluids experiment we had on board, which was an awful lot of fun, was the fiber-supported droplet combustion experiment. We put a small drop of a fuel on a fiber, and the only purpose of the fiber was to keep the drop where we wanted it to be, and ignite it. In one camera view, this one, you could just see the drop shrinking as it's being consumed. In another camera view, you can't see much of the color of the flame front, but you can see that the fiber on either side of the drop is being heated, and that's where the flame front is propagating. We learned a lot from doing a drop physics module on how to deploy these drops and get these guys burning. There was a little bit of trouble with this experiment, as anybody who worked the flight here knows. Mike was our IFM person on this and got it working.
We also had another series of theoretical, I'd call them, experiments on crystal growth. And what we were looking at is hard sphere models and how they would represent the formation of a crystal structure and the interface between that crystal structure and the fluid from which it formed. And we also use lasers to look at diffraction patterns to find out exactly where that interface was and what kind of crystal formed. And the crystal structures that were formed were not those that were predicted. They're still analyzing why that is. So that was kind of a surprise.
The payload crew, the four of them were in the lab, the orbiter crew, we had some experiments up in the mid-deck too that we were working on. We activated and deactivated some protein crystal growth experiments. We also, and I'm from potato country in Colorado, was pretty proud of the fact we managed to grow 5 potatoes in space. And I'll let Mike talk about that.
This is just an example of me giving some CO2 to the plants inside. And the real goal behind the experiment was to determine how to make a nutrient delivery system, both water and other nutrients, to the plants in case we, for long duration missions, we need to know how to grow those foods so that we don't have to take them with us.
We also did our part for medical science, and here I'm doing a neurovestibular DSO, and it has to do with the rate your eyeball can track.
Well, this is how we got all those Earth Ops pictures you saw at the beginning of the presentation. Take one of those big Hasselblad cameras, point out the window, and this is the scene that the operator would see. Up in the top is the west coast of California, and you can see the greens of the trees and the mountains, and then the yellow stripe there in the middle is the northern San Joaquin Valley. Next green stripe is the Sierra Nevada, and then you'll see the browns of the high desert. Lake Tahoe and Pyramid Lake will just start to come into view. You can see it doesn't go by very fast. Most of you have seen this sort of view before. But you really realize you're going fast when you think of the distance involved in just this 30 or 40 second picture. First week, we had really clear views of almost the whole United States. So we got to take a lot of shots of a lot of different cities, especially potato country in Colorado.
This next sequence here is over the, we're currently over India now, looking north, and those are the Himalayas there in the middle of the screen with the Brahmaputra River, both on the south side of the Himalayas and also on the north side of the Himalayas. And you can see the vast difference in both color, which basically is vegetation, and also elevation. This was Super Typhoon Angela, which was taken over the Philippine Sea, which hit that set of islands with winds over 200 miles an hour. And you can just make out the circular formation in the clouds, although on this particular shot, you don't really get any sense of an eye in the middle of the hurricane, but it was certainly strong nonetheless. This was an attempt at a night scene. We were over sort of central United States here looking west, and that line on the left isn't the horizon, believe it or not, it's the edge of the atmosphere, and that'll become more clear in a second. But if you watch this star up here, it'll actually go below it, and you'll see it what will look like through the Earth. So that's clearly not the edge of the Earth. So this is the thickness of the atmosphere. And these are the lights of big cities. There were Washington, Baltimore, Philadelphia, and here comes the Big Apple. And as the sun rises, which is about to do, it washes out the camera, the sensitivity changes, and sort of made our own fade to white, I guess.
The daily maintenance was done, and filter cleaning, and being the pilot.
The rookie always gets to clean the vehicle, which we have to do every day. The bacteria builds up quite aggressively in orbit.
There's no floor, there's no down, so dust accumulates in the different places in the filters because it's always floating in the air. So anywhere it's drawn, you've got to make sure you get to it. Space did lend itself to some innovative cleaning styles that were a lot more fun up there than on Earth.
We carried another computer on board to do the pilot simulation. That was a really useful piece of gear, I thought, to help me prepare for my first space shuttle landing. And this is what it looked like on the scene. Just like out the window of the real orbiter.
This is the blue crew enjoying lunch. As you can see, I'm finishing up my lunch back there. Fred is cleaning his silverware with a handy wipe. And Katie has probably read the news, some humorous story. But we did that. We got an hour off in the middle of our 12-hour day. And the mail we'd get up electronically on a keyboard, sort of like email.
We got our mail up on the KCA link. I'll talk about that after the World Series, maybe.
Yeah, you may have seen us. We got the chance to throw out the first pitch in Game 5 of the World Series, which was really a lot of fun. And more importantly, we got a chance to watch it. You can see us in the lower right-hand corner watching the monitor, and we're seeing the image that you see in the upper left-hand corner.
I'm about to do a magic trick.
And at the end of the mission, or close to the end of the mission, we had put everything away. We're getting a little bored, so we decided that we'd do a little magic show. And I've tried for years to do that, never been able to do it. But now the trick was to get it down without doing something bad.
Hal's a pretty good magician. It's important to take those breaks on orbit. They help you stay recharged and do good work while you're up there. All good things have to come to an end, and this is how we started getting ready to come home, checking out the systems on the orbiter. Then it was time to close up the payload bay doors, say goodbye to the view out the window, and get ready to come home.
The entry was spectacular. Being a first-timer sitting up in the front, the orange-pink glow was just fantastic looking through the windows. This was a shot on entry taken from a guy in Denver on top of his house with his handycam and sent it to us. Anyway, we came around the hack shortly after sunrise, coming down the 18-degree glide slope at 300 knots. Sox just had the guidance nailed, doing a beautiful job. And it's very dynamic. It's like trying to land a bomb, because this is similar to a bombing profile that you'd fly in the Navy. I got the gear out at 300 feet. We came across the threshold right where we should have been, touched down 2,500 feet down the runway. And the landing was so smooth, I'd like to take this chance to brag about Sox. And it's uncharacteristic of a Navy pilot, but this landing was so smooth. It was like on an airline landing, when the landing is so smooth, everybody in the cabin just claps and cheers. And in fact, that's what happened on our landing when we touched down. You could barely tell we'd touched down.
Ken had to do the most important thing on the mission, though, get the gear down, and you can see he did that successfully. Columbia was a beautiful vehicle. It was a little slow getting off the pad, but it was worth the wait, because when we got out there, there were very few problems. And it really proved itself to be a wonderful platform for science.
So that's it. So I guess I'm willing to answer any questions. If you guys, I know it's been a long program, but hopefully you got a sense of what it feels like to be in the astronaut corps. So when you get to see your next movie, you'll have a better idea of what the real is and what the not so real is. Yes.
Especially with arthritis going up there, that cures everything. You don't feel that arthritis attack?
No.
When you come back down, because they say that your skeleton grows a little bit?
Yeah, not your skeleton, but the muscles in between you. I was, for the first time, the right weight for my height. I grew about 2.5 inches. When I came back, I had some back aches and back problems when I came back, because it didn't align itself very well coming back. But I adjusted after a while and it was fine. But we have a lot of back problems sometimes. We have to be very careful of it when we come back. It's also some practical problems. For example, when you get into the flight suit, the launch and entry suit on the ground, it's bigger than you need. And the reason for that is when you get into orbit, you're going to be 2.5 inches tall, an inch or taller, so you have to make it adjust, because when you get in an orbit, you have to be able to get into it. So on the ground, it's very big and bulky, but in orbit, it fits more profile, when you come first down. That's a good question. Yes? Yeah, Earth. Yeah. No, Earth is the only planet I get to land on, yeah.
Or some of the things you did to pass the time.
Well, we had 12-hour days, and we were timed. Everything was timed, including our bathroom breaks and eating breaks. So the only time I really had that, halfway through the flight, we were given an option of having a day off. actually a half a day off, but I chose to do some science because that's what I was there for, and that was what relaxed me. So I did a little bit more science and got some more stuff done. Other than that, we're in bed. We relax in the sense that we listen to the music we were interested in, and we had the opportunity to look at videos that we had brought on board and others if we wanted to. But most of the time, as I explained before, I would be reading what I expected to do that day to make sure that I was current on everything I was trying to do. And we would have uplinks every once in a while that would say, hey, they made a modification to this experiment. You need to incorporate this. So I'd be reading that and make sure I was doing what I was doing correctly.
Do we have any further questions?
Yes. Yeah, I saw a lot of planets in space, but from a distance, they look like big stars. Mars, of course, looks a little off-colored, looks orangey sort of looking. I saw Mercury, I saw a variety of different planets, but they look pretty much like big stars, like the North Star here. I think there was a, yes. Yeah, well, I agree with that. I really do agree with that. I don't know about the timing. He's a lot smarter than I am, but I do believe the future of humankind is beyond what we now call Earth. And I also believe when you're in space, you get a sense that you're one with the universe, because think of it for a minute. When I looked at the Earth and then looked out in the cosmos, the Earth is like the smallest grain of sand on the biggest beach you've ever seen, which means all of us are pretty insignificant, if you think about it. And that's what really strikes you. Is that the Earth is pretty insignificant in the overall scheme of things, so it only makes sense that our future is beyond where we are, and there's billions and billions of Earth-like planets mathematically shows, and that's what he's basing it on. The question is, those enormous distances to travel is the thing that's really something that's a challenge, and it's difficult for me to wrap my mind around how we're going to make those leaps without having generational ships that you start off with one generation, it's three generations later that make it. Yes.
It's significant to note that on this particular flight, there were women astronauts, but that the resulting women astronauts was due to the fact that prior to this, women had to lobby to become astronauts.
Yeah.
And I think that that's a part of the process of development that. Eventually, we'll be on Mars, and some students at UMass Lowell have contracted with NASA to produce a robot that will push the button so that the beam can expand on Mars, because humans can't get there first.
Yep.
So that it's a process, and I look on these students as part of that process.
Well, I would agree with that. That's true. Yes, sir.
What's your opinion about Elon Musk's initiative of getting to Mars by 2023?
Yeah. Well, I met him a couple of times, and in fact, Ken Bowersox is my commander was a consultant for him. So I think, you know, he's the kind of guy that is very futuristic, is willing to put his money where his mouth is, right? And he really wants to push the envelope. So whether we'll get there then or not, I don't know, but he'll do a lot to get us there quicker than we normally would. I don't know if we can get there that quickly. I mean, we really have the capability to get there. It's whether or not we have the resolve to get there. That's a whole different thing. I mean, our space program now is pretty much gutted. I mean, there's not much left of it.
You showed some very nice slides of crystals growing on the space station.
Yeah.
Is the development of the crystal lattice in space more efficient than it is in a gravitational environment?
Yeah, and the way to think about it is, think about being inside a washing machine, and think of crystals as like building blocks. So think of a bunch of building blocks going around in a washing machine that have to be put in a specific order, and you have to pick up one and grab it as it comes by and put it in. That's what happens in a gravitational field because of the movement of fluids. Or if it's a protein which folds, think about folding a towel while you're in a washing machine that's flipping around. But when you're in the free fall environment of low Earth orbit, because you don't have any of that fluid motion, everything vibrates into place. So that block just sits there and you can place it in. So the structure is all the same, but the efficiency of putting it together, it's an efficiency in the sense of you don't have motion going against where you want to put things. Not so much time, because when things vibrate into place, it's slower, but. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I've been out of school since 70s, so I'm here to learn something. I'm amazed. I would never see an astronaut in front of me if my job would have closed down, because I'm getting some knowledge now.
Yeah.
I gotta get GED and all that. But it's amazing, you know. A lot of things I didn't really care for this, you know, because I was a truck driver. And,
yeah.
You know, you go forward, go back, and that's it, you know. But I'm amazed I met a
Well, thank you. And I appreciate what you've done. Without truck drivers, this country would be in real big trouble. You know, they move everything everywhere. So everybody plays a part in what we call this great country, and it is certainly the greatest country in the world.
We'll take one last question, and then we have to wrap it up.
Yes.
How do you feel about the space program being gutted, and how's it going to affect future generations?
Well, obviously, I'm not pleased with it. I feel like a part of history rather than a part of something that I thought was the great adventure of our time. You know, I feel like people read about us in history books and usually get it messed up. But nevertheless, I don't feel good about that. I mean, I really don't, and none of my colleagues do. To a one, I was at a convention. Every 2 years, all the astronauts get together, and I was talking to Mike Collins, who was the command pilot of Apollo 11, and Buzz Aldrin, and Alan Bean, and a couple of the real, what I call the real astronauts, the real people that did things that didn't know what was going to happen. And they're all pretty sad. I mean, it's pretty sad what it's come to. So in terms of how it's going to affect young people, I think young people need role models. And the role models that they have today, I don't consider to be role models. And it doesn't matter whether you become an astronaut, but the idea to reach for your dreams. My parents always said, you know, never let your fears get in the way of your dreams. And I talked about that at the very beginning. And this is the problem with the generation, that some of the, they don't know the role model. They don't know what to aspire to. And, you know, I did. I mean, I didn't know I'd be an astronaut. I wanted to be, but the chances were not that large. But it made me want to reach beyond and dream of what I could do. And how could I make an impact, and how can I do good things? And I'm sure there's role models today. You know, I'm not sure Kim Kardashian and those folks are real role models, but it's in what you see. I will say this about today's youth. They're smarter than we were. They're brighter than we were. Most of them, almost all of them, want to do something that's good for the world. They're much more outward looking than we were, and I think that's all good. The question is to give them the ability to do that, and let them go. Let them do what they need to do, because the world certainly needs a lot of help, a lot more than it ever has in the past in some ways. But I did my little part, and that's why I always at the end I tell you the four things, my grand challenges to the up-and-coming generation, because that's your challenge, and it's a big one, it's a huge one. And I'm a big proponent of the STEM fields, and my feeling is, and I tell this to my students all the time, if you're a doctor, you help one person. If you're a nurse, you help 30 people. If you're an engineer, you help millions of them. You develop power plants, you develop the new power for the future, you develop everything. So if you have an inclination to become an engineer, that's the best thing if you want to really change the world, in my estimation. But anything you do, do it well, and recognize, and this is why I say everything that anybody does anywhere else in the world affects us, so don't think it does. So don't turn a blind eye to what's happening in Europe, to what's happening in South America, what's happening in Asia, because it will happen here. We'll feel the reflection of that. And you need to realize that when you're in space, you realize this globe that we all live on, we're all part of the greater human family, no matter where you live in it, and we need to take care of each other. So thank you. Thank you so much.
Wow, just wow. The One Book Committee, again, would like to thank Dr. Sacco for taking time out of his busy schedule to come talk to us and our community. I am blown away. I've learned so much. It was just a fabulous presentation. I think everyone's walking away with some new knowledge, and especially at this trying time to realize that we are just one planet, one human being, right? So keep posted. One Book is getting ready for soliciting suggestions for our book to use next fall, 2017. Every year we pick one book to bring the college community back together, and faculty and staff use it in their classes. And so keep lookout for some announcements to send us your titles. Who knows, maybe your book will be the next one book. So again, thank you, Dr. Sacco. We truly appreciate it.